Happy Easter above and beyond. We are so glad you could join us for our online Easter service. The Bible says, "Praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us a new living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." That being said, let us celebrate today, because when we had no hope, Jesus Christ rose from the dead. He had given us a new living hope. So join us in a celebration as we praise our Lord and Savior.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Church, Easter might look very different this year, but it does not make it any less meaningful. We actually believe the complete opposite of that. We believe that the circumstances that we're in right now actually position us for our faith to be made stronger, for us to be able to celebrate Easter on a deeper level, even when things might feel lost and vain. We can turn our eyes to Jesus and remember that our God only knows how to triumph. Our God is victorious. He is risen. There's victory in Christ. The God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. Yeah, I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Yeah, I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, oh, oh. Yeah. he wages, he will win. And I'm not backing down from any trying, 'cause I know how this story ends. Time to celebrate. good and your mercy endureth forever. Come on, let's sing that again. Sing, Lord, you are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever.
Struck wonder. those lyrics remind me that we don't have to give. We get to give. We get to give out of a heart of love, out of a grateful heart of love to the one who was, who is, and the one who is to come. It's your generosity right now that will help people in need. Some have lost their jobs, some cupboards are bare, and the rent will soon be due. And so we give. We give because he's given to us. And so right now, whether it's through the app, our website, or whether it's the U.S. Postal Service, why not give so that others can be blessed? In Jesus' name, pray with me right now. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for Jesus, who for our sakes emptied himself so that in his poverty we could be made rich. We want to give in faith so that others can receive. In Jesus' name we pray.
Welcome, ABCC family. Thank you so much for joining us on our live stream today as we stream our Easter service. And if you're joining us for the first time, we want you guys to know that our church exists to know God, make him known, impacting lives, and loving on our community. We are so excited to celebrate Easter with you guys, and we want to feel so connected to you guys. So we want to see how good you guys look today. So go ahead and take a picture of you and your family so we can share your Easter experience with the rest of our ABCC family. Church, our staff has been working so hard to keep moving forward during these tough times, and we want to make that visible to you guys. So go ahead and check out our website and see our new Kids Ministry tab. We have also made other resources available to you guys, including prayer. We all know how important and vital prayer can be in our daily lives and these tough times, and we want to walk through that with you guys. Our cares and concerns belong to God. We've also made another resource available to you guys on the app, which is Grief Share. So go ahead and check that out. Also, this Wednesday, April 15th at 7 p.m., Pastor Ken Whiteman will be starting a 12-week course titled Living with Hope. And happening this Friday, we are having Celebrate Recovery online. So go on the app or the website to learn more information regarding those events. Lastly, church, we know how much you guys miss connecting and having that special time together. So we invite you guys to stay after the stream and chat for a little bit in the comment section. That's all the announcements we have for you guys today. Let's rejoice. It's Easter. He is risen. And remember, you belong here.
Hey, happy Easter, everybody. So glad that you're here and you're with us today. I want you to know I consider it a privilege anytime I get to stand up here and just to give the gospel. God uses it. Sometimes I just ask him why, but he does. And so I am thankful and I'm grateful that I'm here with you today on Easter 2020. So today I want to talk to you about 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 54 to 58. Easter 2020, I titled the message, Your Labor is Not in Vain. Your labor is not in vain. Let me start out with some riddles. I know that's probably not what you normally get on Easter morning, Easter, but today we'll start out with some riddles. Two fathers and two sons go fishing. They all catch a fish. They all catch their own fish. They all bring their own fish home. When they get home, there's three fish. How can that be? A man rode in to town on Friday. He stayed three nights, then left on Friday. Now, how is that possible? Well, he was riding a horse called Friday. Mr. Black asked for tea. He got $5,000. He then asked for eyes, but Mrs. White couldn't give him any. Who is Mr. Black? Well, Mr. Black is a contestant on the show Wheel of Fortune. Did you ever play those kind of mind games? Some of us will sit for hours in order to figure them out. Others will simply wonder, whoever thought these up had way too much time on their hands. Especially when you hear the answers and you really dislike them. It's called lateral thinking. Just so you won't be trying to figure out that first one I gave you for the rest of the time we're together, I'm going to go ahead and give you the answer for the first question. Two fathers, two sons, they go fishing. They all bring home their own fish. One of them was a grandfather. Make sense? Okay. Well, look, now that you've got the hang of it, I want to try one more riddle this morning. On Friday night, a man dies. He's buried that same night. On Sunday morning, his friends arrive at the grave, only discover his body is gone. What happened? You see, one of the problems of Jesus' resurrection is that some people try to make sense out of everything that happened. They try to understand exactly how Jesus could die and then come back to life again. And let me tell you something, and it's a secret, all right? So I'm just going to let you guys know, and we're going to keep it amongst the family. Ready? Here's the secret. None of it makes sense. Yeah, I know some of you are wondering, what in the world is he talking about? But think about it from a rational, logical, analytical mind. Does it make sense that a man can be dead for 3 days, come back to life? No, it doesn't make any sense. I mean, think about it. If the brain goes out without oxygen for 3 days, your blood stops, your body stops, everything stops for 3 days, could that person logically come back to life? Let me ask you how much of life really does make sense if you really think about it. Look at the headlines over the past week. We've read about more than 3,000 people who died in China, where the virus first began. Italy has 18,000 people that has died. Spain has 15,000 people that have died from this virus. In the United States, there's been more than 18,000 people that have died because of this virus. Now, where did it come from? Doesn't any of this make any sense? Yet all of it is real. This is life, real life taking place. And there is the question that all of us are asking, where is God in all of this? What is his will for us? Let's pray. Dear Father God, I come before you right now with a grateful, thankful heart, Lord, that you came, that you lived here among us, you taught us, you performed miracles. Lord, then you laid down your life upon a cross for us. And then 3 days later, you came out of that grave. You were resurrected, and you provided for us such a way. Lord, this morning, as we just go through your word and we look at it and we talk about it, God, I just pray that you'll open our hearts and our minds. Lord, this is a time in the United States and the world that, Lord, that we're just all a little bit on edge. Lord, there's things that are happening that touch the very essence of who humans are. When it comes to a life and death situation, folks, that's where it really hits us. And so, God, I'm asking you this morning, Lord, just give us this next little bit of time together, a time of peace. Lord, a time where we can just slow down our heart rate. Lord, we can just stop and say, okay, God, I'm here. I'm listening. What do you want? Lord, thank you for meeting with us. Lord, thank you for bringing this church together. It's never been about a building. It's never been about seats. It's never been about the black wall. It's been about people. And this morning, God, your people have gathered together wherever they are, and they are forming the church. God, speak to the church this morning. Touch our hearts. Lord, each and every one this morning, God, I ask you to reach out and be there for us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. I'm going to read the scriptures this morning from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 54 to 58. It says this: so when this corruptible has put on incorruption and this mortal has put on immortality, Then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the word of the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So I have a question for this morning. How do we who claim to confront death with a different heart, a Christian-centered heart, react to this crisis? And more importantly, what are we as Christians supposed to be doing? I mean, death is the ultimate test of our faith. It is the ultimate, ultimate test. Being a faithful Christian doesn't keep us from death. Unless Christ comes again before we die and we meet him in the sky, every one of us have a time and a place where we will die. And none of us can avoid that. When it's our time, it's our time. That means that we must recognize death for what it is. An enemy that has entered the human race as God cursed on us for our sins. It is our enemy. And when the Bible says that Christ abolished death, in 2 Timothy 1 verse 10, it means that he broke the power over death for us as believers. Isn't that amazing? Death has been broken. It is our enemy. And if we look at death that way, then I think we'll look at it with a little less fear in our hearts. Death is an enemy that Christ has overcome. I know a lot of questions. Sometimes there's not a lot of answers. But I will tell you, there is one answer I do have for you today. It is the reality of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Why do we believe? Well, recently a person from another faith was converted to Christ. And somebody asked him and said, why did you change your faith? Why did you convert to Christianity? And the fellow said, well, let me put it to you this way. He said, if you're walking down a road, and on this road you came to a fork in the road, and at the fork of the road, there's two people, and one's alive and one's dead, which one would you ask for directions? You see, that's the difference between all other religions and the gospel. You see, we serve a risen Christ. Jesus Christ came, he lived, he died, and he rose again. We are the only ones that serve a risen Savior. That is the difference. This side of history, the cross, we understand that Jesus' death was necessary. Without his death, there could be no resurrection. Now, just so I let everybody know, when we're talking about the cross, and we're talking about this side of the cross or that side of the cross, this side is the Old Testament. They were looking forward to the cross. And when you're on the other side, this side is the New Testament, and we look back to the cross. So the whole Bible, if you break it down into two pieces, that's what it is. In a nutshell, if you're looking forward, that means you're in the Old Testament. If you're looking back, you're out of the New Testament. It's really quite that simple. Which brings me to my 2 points. I only have 2 points this morning that I'd like to share with you. Point number one, the cross. Point number one, the cross. He laid his life down for us. He willingly gave it all. But how did his friends react? How did they view the cross back then? Well, the answer to that question would be from a distance. Well, except for Peter, they weren't even there. They didn't even show up. The cross was the ultimate symbol of shame. It was reserved for vile criminals. So the disciples' teacher, the one they left their boats, their nets, their jobs, their homes, their friends, their family for, to follow, was hung on a cross. And when he was, they turned their backs on him. No doubt, they viewed the cross as shameful. Perhaps they even began to question the wisdom of their decision to follow him. They were delusioned, they were disappointed, and they certainly were afraid. I mean, the crowd at the time, if you've ever seen some of the movies or some of the things they've done, was out of control. They're screaming and yelling, and they had the Pharisees standing behind them and the religious leaders, and they were getting them all charred up. Whenever you see a riot, you always got to find the one person that's causing everybody else to get mad. Usually it's one or two people, and then the rest of them just go crazy. So here they are. The whole crowd is going nuts, going crazy. The soldiers could come at any time and take them away, just like they took away Jesus. So I'm pretty confident the disciples were afraid. I remember my first car. It was a beautiful 76 Ford Pinto. Now, I've told a few stories about that car, and this is just another one, but that was a red, candy apple red, my favorite color of cars, candy apple red. It had black stripe over the hood, down the back. I put small tires on the front. I put wide tires on the back. I put little horses on either side. This car looked tough. It looked like a muscle car. This car had a four-cylinder engine, and it was not tough. It was slow. Let me tell you, that little four-cylinder engine did not go fast. Matter of fact, I remember one time I was driving from Truro, where I lived, to Halifax. It was about 60 miles away, and three of my friends went with me, and that's pretty well it. Four in the car, we were done. But we're driving along, and we're on the highway, and it was one of those days where nobody was on the highway, so I was going to see if I could do how fast this car would go. So I put the pedal to the metal, and I gave her everything she had. We made it to 99, literally 99. And I thought, oh, man, I just want to do 100. So we all started doing this. And then we go, 100, 100, 100. But that was my car. And it developed a problem. The car got a toe to the right, meaning the front wheels got out of alignment. And so when you're driving along, it was hard to keep it in the left lane because it always was pulling to the right. Now, if you let go of the wheel, it was great because it would automatically go in the right lane. Matter of fact, it would go so far it could make a right-hand turn. I kind of felt like the Kit car. Remember, what was the name of that show? Kit was the Knight Rider. Remember the car that could drive by itself? And everybody thought, man, there'll never be a car that could drive by itself. We thought that was so cool. Now they got cars all over the place, drive by themselves. But that car would go and do what it want when you let go of the steering wheel. It would go to the right. Now, I have a question for you this morning. This is a very important question. If you just let go of the wheel of your life, where would your mind and your heart take you? Think about that for a second. You know, it's easy when we're in a situation where we get up in the morning, we go to work, we come home, we do blah, 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 and everything is put together, and we all have this regiment that we do every day. And so life is basically the same old, but now, because of this virus, we're home. We spend a lot of time at home. Things are different. Things aren't the same as it were. So it's like letting go of the steering wheel. And my question to you is, where does your life and your heart go when you do that? Are you spending more time in God's Word? Are you learning more? Or are you binge watching Tiger King? Where does it go? Where does your life steer you? What focus are tugging on you these days? What is taking your attention off Christ and his love for you, his plan for you, his forgiveness, his mercy, his grace? What is it that you're doing in this new time, this area where we could just take our hands off life and sit at home? Is it a relationship troubles that you're working on? Is it health concerns? Is it financial? Is it a sin that you refuse to see as sin? Something from your past that you're having a hard time letting go? Is it the virus that is consuming your time? These are all kinds of distractions that are out there. Any number of sin can get into us so far and get us so far off course that we possibly can't get back on our own. That's life sometimes, isn't it? It gets us so far off course when we let go, we can't possibly get back. And that's the bad news. But here's the good news. You ready for this? What Jesus told his disciples, he said, with man, it is impossible, but not with God, for all things are possible with God. You know what that tells me? For as much as our focus gets pulled away from God, he never takes his eyes off you. He never will. Wow. Think about that. No matter how far off the beaten path we go, no matter how many turns or right lanes or wherever we are, God always has his eyes on us. Even when we don't have our eyes on him, he never takes his eyes off us. That's a loving God. That's a God that cares about us. As much as we go to one extreme or the other, the cross is always there in the center of our life. Isn't that cool? This Bible, everything that goes along with it, the stories, how the cross, before, after, everything in the center, New Testament, Old Testament, it comes down to the cross is always in the center of our life. No matter which side we go, it's always there. The cross is always the answer to the question, who can be saved? In the miracle of God's mercy, the answer from the cross is you. You can be saved. And by believing in the shedding of Christ's blood, you are. Which brings me to my last point, the tomb. The tomb. When it happened, Jesus broke through the chains of death and rose from the grave. He appeared to women at the empty tomb. He gave them the word to tell the disciples. Later, he appeared before the disciples. But Thomas wasn't there. And I want to talk about Thomas a little bit this morning. When the disciples found Thomas and told him the good news, Jesus had risen, Thomas doubted the apostles' testimony. Thomas doubted their testimony of seeing Jesus alive. Let's read it. Matter of fact, let's go to John chapter 20, verse 24 and 25. It says this. Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. And so the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. Why did Thomas doubt? Why? Why did Thomas doubt? Well, here's the reasons that I came up with. He heard about the vicious way that they had driven the nails into the hands instead of tying them to the tree. He heard that the way the soldiers had stabbed him in the side with a spear like a piece of meat. He'd heard that they buried him in a tomb. His anger, his fears blended to become a toxic cocktail of bitterness, and so he doubted. I mean, logically thinking, if you're just thinking not from your heart but your mind, and you hear all those things like Thomas heard, then what would he be thinking? He was dead. He's dead. I don't know what you guys saw, but they hung him, they stabbed him, they put him in the grave. It's been 3 days. He's what? Dead. And that's logically what he thought. And it didn't matter what other people told him because he was thinking. Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. Do you blame him? Logically, Christ was dead. But let's go on. Let's read on. Let's read John chapter 20, verse 26 and 27. A week later, the disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them this time. The doors were locked, and Jesus came and stood among them. I just got to stop for a second. The doors were locked. So that means that what they're saying is that Jesus wasn't the same guy he used to be. Now he could teleport. Man, long before Star Trek was teleporting, he did it first. I just wanted to put that out there. I know I get sidetracked. But here they are. They're in a room. It's a week later, and Jesus comes and he stands beside them. And he says, peace be with you. And then he said to Thomas, put your fingers here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put them in my side. Stop doubting and believe. You know what I love about this? What I love about what you see here that we don't talk about much is he didn't come in and condemn him. He didn't say, what, you don't believe? And he didn't get all over him. What did he say? Hey, here I am. Go ahead, touch him. And you know what else? He knew what Thomas was thinking. He didn't have to be told what he was thinking. He knew. God knows every thought that we have. He knows everything that we say. He knows everything that we think. And he knew. And when he got there, he said, hey, here I am. Go ahead. And he didn't do it with condemnation. He did it out of love. And I love what comes next. You ready for this? John chapter 20, verse 28 says this, my Lord and my God. Thomas, by his actions, said, seeing is believing. But we know that believing is seeing, Jesus said to him. John 20, 29 says this, because you have seen me, you believe. Blessed are they who did not see and yet believe. You figure out, folks, that that's you and me. We've not seen, yet as Christians, we believe. That means God's given us an extra blessing to believe. Not thinking about it, but using our heart and saying, you know what? I know there's something real there. God, I believe. I believe. A volunteer at Stanford Hospital was present when a little boy decided to give the ultimate sacrifice because he loved his sister, Lisa. The volunteer said the little girl was dying of a rare disease and only one chance for her to survive, a blood transfusion from her brother, who was 5 years old, who had the same type of blood. After the doctors explained what would happen during the transfusion, the little boy agreed to give his blood to save his sister. He peacefully lay down during the transfusion, and after a while, as he asked the doctor a question that gave great insight to this little boy's character, the question that he asked was, will I start dying right away? Apparently, the little boy thought he would have to give all his blood, but he was willing to do to save his sister. Wow. John 15, verse 13 says this, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. That a man would lay down his life for his friends. Wow. Wow. Jesus laid down his life for you to make room at the cross for you. Will you come to him today? There are many things that have happened that we believe in Jesus. I want to end today by highlighting a few things. When we believe in Jesus, these are some of the things that happen. And so this morning I want to talk about it. We come to realize that the bonds of death have been broken forever. The enemy, death, we no longer have to fear it. Those bonds that when we die are broken, because God says, if you believe in me, you'll have everlasting life. We understand that life is not all that there is, that this life is not all that there is, that there's more to come. Man, we have heaven. We got so much more to come. We have eternal life with God when we die as believers in Christ. And again, I say, we have heaven. So when you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, a lot comes with it, a lot. 1 Corinthians verse 15, or chapter 15, verse 55 says this. Paul wrote, and so when this corruptible has put on incorruption, this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? What that says is, when Jesus died and 3 days later rose again, he broke that enemy's back. He said, there is no such thing as death that will kill us forever. You see, when Adam and Eve sinned, because of their sins, they were surely to die, right? And so one day they did, and as we all do. That was the reason. I'm trying to think of a word here. I'll get it in a second. That would be why God said that, you know what? You broke it, now you die. And we all do. But Jesus, through his shed blood on the cross, laid his life down for us and rose again. He broke death. That enemy no longer exceeds. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? Dear friends, that is the great news of Easter. It has been swallowed up by God forever. Let the empty tomb give us victory over death. The struggles that we endure in life is real, but they're not in vain. I realize that we're doing some struggles right now. I realize that we're going through some hard times here in America and the rest of the world, but it is not in vain. I want you to remember that, not in vain. We know that in heaven there will be no more tears, no more pain, no more suffering, no more hunger, no more cold, no more hot weather or cold weather. I want to close with one last story. Every year, thousands of people climb a mountain in Italy, the Italian Alps. passing by a station, and this last station before the top is called the Station of the Cross. So like it says, at the very top, there is a shrine put up of a cross. And so thousands of people every year at Easter climb up this mountain to worship and to have a service together at the cross. And one time they're all up there and they're looking at the cross and they're having a service around the cross. And one person was looking around, and as they looked at the cross, they noticed that there was an old path behind the cross. And they thought, man, I wonder what that old path is for. And they started looking at the old path and following it, and they had to get through some bushes and a little tree, and they pushed it aside. And as they broke into the next part of the top of that mountain, they found another shrine. They found the empty tomb. You see, many people found the cross, and they stopped, and they never experienced the empty tomb. Far too many have gotten to the cross and have known the despair, the pain, the heart wreck. The cross has become a symbol on a chain. How many people do you see that wear the cross, that have that cross on, and you look at them and think, why are they wearing that cross? Because the cross symbols pain and suffering. It symbols putting in time. Like if you're a basketball player, all the time and all the effort and everything you put in there to become that player, that great player, that cross is that symbol of pain and suffering. There are people that have problems in their life and there's pain and suffering, and that cross symbolizes that. That cross has become to know that. But if that's all you have is the cross, then you have nothing. But far few have moved beyond the cross and found the real message of Easter, and that's the message of the empty tomb. The resurrection will change your life, but only if you personally trust in the risen Christ. Your forgiveness, your shepherd, your leader, you do that with your heart. That's how you accept Jesus Christ. There are so many things in this Bible that logically just hard to understand. Hard to get it. And that's where faith comes in. That's where faith says, you know what? I feel in my heart. And right now, if you're home and you're watching this and you're saying, wow, I do. There's something tugging at me. That's Jesus Christ. That's the Holy Spirit saying, follow your heart. Some of it may not make sense, but that's okay, because if we just have the faith to believe and accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, the fear of death is broken. The fears that we have are broken. Christ says, I have come in. I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and open that door, I will come in. This morning, I'd like to read a prayer for you. If you're in that situation, you're saying, you know what? I'm ready. Pastor, I am ready. I am ready to step across that door. I am ready to make a commitment. Then just repeat after me. You ready? Just repeat this as I read through it this morning. Jesus, I am yours and you are mine. Forgive me for all my sins, the ones I can name and the ones that I've forgotten. I want you. I need you. I believe that Jesus Christ shed his precious blood and died for my sins on that cross. I believe that Jesus Christ, 3 days later, came out of the tomb and rose again. I am willing to turn from sin. I now invite Christ to come into my heart and my life as my personal Savior. Lord, come in today and save me. My friends, if you've said that this morning, if you made that prayer your commitment this morning, I'm happy to tell you that Jesus Christ came into your life and saved you. Make the claim today that Jesus is yours. What better day to do it than on Easter? We're home. We're confined. We have a lot of time. We don't have any excuses now. It's time to face the fact that we need a risen Savior. Jesus Christ has come to save and to seek the lost. So this morning, my prayer is that you've prayed that prayer, that you've accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. He is Lord, and we all praise God for our blessings in Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. My friends, your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Remember I told you, remember that, not in vain? In the Lord. That's what brings the whole thing together. That's what makes the whole thing real. Christian, what are you supposed to be doing? You're supposed to be working in the Lord. Man, is there a neighbor that you haven't talked to? Is there somebody that you haven't visited? Is there a phone call that you haven't made? Is there something that you should be doing? Work in the Lord that we've been putting off, that we've just been too busy? Well, guess what? We're not so busy right now, are we? So as Christians, we need to be reaching out to people that are hurting. The world is hurting. Maybe you're a cook. Maybe you're a baker. Maybe, I don't know. But I know God wants us as Christians to reach out. Because, listen, right now, the fear that this virus is causing in the world is real. I gave you the numbers of how many thousands of people are going to die. You may be the last lifeline that they have to find the risen Savior. On this Easter day, why don't you ask God to open a door, and whatever door he opens, don't be afraid to go through. Amen? Let's pray. Dear Father God, I'm so grateful, so thankful for today. Lord, I'm thankful for that you sent your son. Man, I can't even understand it, Lord. You sent your son to come to earth, to live, to teach, and ultimately to die. Lord, he took upon on that cross our sins. He died in our place. He was a man who was sinless. And yet, he took our sins and paid the price for us on that cross. But Lord, we can't stop there, because 3 days later he rose again. And Lord, that's what we need to believe, that you came, you lived, you died, but Lord, on the third day you rose again to save us. And God, if we trust you, if we invite you into our heart, someday when we meet you face to face, all you see is your son inside of us, and you say, come in, well done, you good and faithful servant. That's all it is. God, this morning, bless each person. Bless America. Bless the people that are watching over us right now, Lord. Lots going on. But God, we know that you're in control. We know that, Lord, this didn't take you by surprise. We know that, Lord, there's a reason for everything. And even though sometimes we don't get it, and we can't answer the riddle, it's okay, God, because you can. And Lord, we trust you. And all God's people said, amen.
The moon and stars, they went. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was falling, his body on the cross, his blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him.
Yeah.
has overcome. As we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah.
Courage today. History has already been written, and it is victorious. He is risen. And all God's people said, He is risen indeed.
The cross has a final word. The cross has a final word. Sorrow may come. The darkest night, but the cross has a final word. The cross has a final word. The cross has a final word. Evil may put up its strong.
make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. As we receive.
Children, their children, his family.